Welcome to the B movie.
I knew that would happen.
Okay. Take two. Welcome to the B movie. Well, I keep wanting to say typecast. Welcome to the B-Movie Cryptcast, the podcast where we explore the dark and twisted world of horror cinema. I'm your host, Mr. Hyde, and with me is my co-host, the Horror Chick.
Hello. Hello, hello. How's it going?
Good, good. You?
Not too bad, not too bad. I'm definitely excited to talk about this one. This was really something. I had never seen it before. Tonight we're going to be talking about The Legend of Lizzie Borden, which was a 1975 American historical mystery TV film directed by Paul Wendkos and starring the lovely Elizabeth Montgomery. Incidentally, in an Emmy-nominated performance as Lizzie Borden, an American woman who was accused of murdering her father and stepmother in 1892. It co-stars Katherine Helmond, who many people will know from Soap, Fritz Weaver, Fionnuala Flanagan, another brilliant actress, and Hayden Rourke. It premiered on ABC Network on February the 10th, 1975, and was nominated for a Golden Globe Award for Best Motion Picture Made for Television in 1976. So it made a pretty big splash back in its day.
Yeah. And you can see why, because this movie was absolutely phenomenal.
Yeah, it was. It was. It's got, a really great cast. I'm just trying to see who else is in it. Just a lot of really familiar faces. Some of the actors you'll have seen in other things.
Especially from the 80s too, right?
Like, yeah.
Anders was really big in St. Elsewhere. Catherine Helm. Yeah. She was in Who's the Boss, wasn't she?
Yes, that's right. She was later on. Yeah. Yeah. Really talented actress. I really enjoy, you know, seeing her in different things over the years. And Fionnuala Flanagan, and I hope I'm pronouncing her name correctly, is another fantastic actress. I've seen her in a few things over the years, and she's
incredible,
brilliant
actress.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen the movie The Others?
Yes.
Nicole Kidman, and she was in that. She was.
Yeah.
Her performance in that movie. Oh my God, it was friggin' amazing.
Yeah.
Fionnuala Flanagan was. Wow.
Yeah, she is an amazing actress.
Cinematography in that movie. Maybe that's something maybe we'll bring up later on in these podcasts.
Yeah. Sounds good. I'd be up for watching that one again. Yeah.
Because the cinematography in that thing, wow, dude. Fuck, man. There's my favorite scene is, oh no, we won't get in. We'll just concentrate on this.
Squirrel.
I'm going to go on the turtle squirrel moment and we'll talk about something else. We're working on.
Easily done.
Yeah.
Getting back to The Legend of Lizzie Borden, I watched this for the very first time for this podcast, and I had lots of mixed feelings watching it. And as you watch Elizabeth Montgomery's character throughout the movie, your opinion of her, or at least mine did, was changing and flipping, and like, mm-hmm. it, you know, yeah. Do you feel sorry for her? Do you think she is genuinely mentally unstable from the very start? When does that occur? Why does that occur? So there's lots of little twists and turns in this that I thought were really good. And it kept me very engaged while I was mm-hmm. watching it.
Yeah, because it makes you think, well, what maybe the Bridget, who played by Fiona Flanagan. Maybe mm-hmm. she was involved somehow because she was looking mighty guilty.
Yes, yeah.
In the course of the movie, right?
Yes, and I think that's where it's quite clever in the way that it's directed and written and acted. Elizabeth Montgomery, what a performance. It was chilling. It was so good because she's so emotionless. And yet you kind of feel sorry for her. It's like she's able to make you think that she's just an absolutely unfeeling monster one minute, and then a completely vulnerable, damaged person the next minute. So that was really well portrayed. I thought that I really enjoyed her character and the way she did it. One of the things that really stood out to me was that at first we see that as a young girl, she, in the flashbacks that she has, or that they show you, she's as a young girl, we know that her mother died when she was very young. And that obviously must have severely traumatized her. And they portray, it's like you're in her mind and she's thinking back to what she remembers of the time. And she remembers her father as being very cruel. And in the scene that they show, there's a scene where it almost to me looked like he had murdered the mother. Mm-hmm. He had done something to her, which she actually witnessed, because it shows her sort of looking through the door or the window or something in the, you know, then he went in and murdered her birds, you know, her pigeons. Yes. And then there's also a hint at an inappropriate quote unquote relationship with Lizzie. Mm-hmm. So you were just like, whoa, you know, where are they going with this? Yeah. And there's a scene where she puts the ring on her father's finger and it's particularly unsettling. You know, and sort of belies the psychological damage that appears to have been done to her. But then I had in my notes, but is it she who was already disturbed and confused, and are all these things in her mind? Because the way the father is shown in other scenes, he seems to be quite gentle. Mm-hmm. So we're not sure whether we're seeing him through Lizzie's eyes or whether we're actually seeing him as he really was. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if you picked up on that.
What I picked up on her performance was she, as Lizzie, was very good at manipulating the people around her. To make her feel sorry for her, but at the same time be happy for her because she's coming off as being strong. And I think that sort of plays us at the same time as a viewer, and I think that was quite cleverly done.
Mm-hmm.
As far as the father goes, I picked up that inappropriate behavior between them. Yes, there's a scene where he rubs her lip and her cheek.
Yeah.
And he says, we used to be very, very close, Lizzie.
That's super creepy.
That was very creepy. And when she went there, when she went really dark, she went dark. Like, that performance was stone cold crazy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when she took one, she took out the stepmother first.
Yep. But
then when the killing happened with her father, there was different facial expressions almost in the coldness between the two killings. That's what I picked up anyways. And then, of course, when she discarded the axe down into the latrine,
yeah,
you want to call that, where they have mm-hmm. their little little toilets inside the, that had to be smelly. Anyways, inside the house. And, yeah. You know, it's when she went, finally went there with the killing. I mean, her Elizabeth Montgomery's performance in that, you know, chilling, amazingly performance by Elizabeth Montgomery.
Yeah, she is. I think she was just a totally underrated actress, really. And I know she was recognized probably around, you know, at the time this was made and for other things. And obviously, she's most well known for Bewitched, which was a lovely show. It was great fun. I grew up watching it, you know, so I've got really fond memories of it. But as a serious actress, I think she was, you know, she deserved a lot more recognition, I think, than she probably got. Going back to when you mentioned the scene where she takes the axe to her stepmother. The scenes that we see, you know, the stepmother just appears to be an absolutely miserable, jealous old hag, you know, and she's got the ear of her father, and she's trying to talk the father into, you know, having Lizzie, you know, sent off somewhere. As I was watching that, as I assumed it was playing out that way, you know, that's all you can think of is just what a horrible, miserable cow she is. So there was, what struck me about that was that, going back to the earlier thought that I had, you start to question towards the end of the film how much of what we were seeing was in Lizzie's mind. Is that how she was perceiving them, or were they that bad? And you kind of almost like think, you know, you can't really blame her for what happens. You know, if everything that happened to her was actually happening and she wasn't imagining any of it, then you can certainly understand why anyone would snap under those circumstances. And there's a scene at the top of the stairs before, in the earlier part of the movie, where Lizzie is stood at the top of the stairs, and poor Fionnuala Flanagan's character is struggling to get the door open because the father's coming home or something. And Lizzie is at the top of the stairs, and she kind of like laughs,
gives us a little
in tackle. A really creepy way. And it was almost like this, you just think, my God, how cold and horrible is she? She's laughing at this poor maid who's already exhausted and been overworked and taken advantage of, you know. And then we find out later that she was actually not laughing at the maid. She was laughing as she was looking at the dead body of her stepmother from the angle of the stairway. The stairs that she was stood on, she could see the woman's body under the bed, you know, and I was thinking that was really well done because they're trying to make you think that she's this cold, calculating, you know, unfeeling thing. But then they twist it round at the end and think, oh, no, she wasn't actually laughing at the maid, you know, so it does keep you guessing.
Yeah. That was definitely a shiver down the spine kind of moment. You're like, ooh, that's cold.
Yeah. And very believably done, you know, and I think that's what was so entertaining, is that it leads you in one direction and you think, my God, and then it leads you in another direction towards the end. The other actor in this that I thought gave an absolutely brilliant performance was Ed Flanders, who plays the
Marcia Knowlton, the prosecutor.
Yes. Yeah. He was superb. And again, he's another very well known brilliant actor who's been in just so many things. His determination, he becomes almost dogged, you know, in his determination to bring her to justice, which in his mind she's guilty before they even get to trial. You know, he's decided in his mind, and he almost becomes a bit Ahab-like about it. And even mm-hmm. his wife starts to notice that he's starting to lose, you know, he's yeah. starting to get a little unbalanced with it. Mm-hmm. And the other underlying theme of that is that it was at a time in history that Ed Flanders' character's sensibilities are not, his reaction to the plight of a woman is he doesn't take it into consideration. It's like women, it's like he makes a comment to her, you know, the next thing you'll say, you know, you want the vote. So it was really telling about the time that this took place and how women were perceived. Mm-hmm. So it would have gone against Lizzie in his mind as well. He was very happy to assume that she had done this because of the fact that she was just an evil person, but wouldn't be able to take in the concept that she may have been driven to it. You know?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And as a side note, Ed Flanders in the girl who, Bonnie Bartlett, who played his wife, mm-hmm. who are in Saint Elsewhere together.
No way. Oh, that's cool. Mm.
Yeah. She was married to the chief of surgeon who was the voice of Kit.
Oh, I know the actor. Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, I used to watch St. Elsewhere. The name's
like, whew, right over my head.
Yeah, that's just
one of my all-time favorite TV shows.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I do remember that show, and I did used to watch it at the time. Didn't there was somebody else, Howie Mandel was in that, wasn't he?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I do remember him. Yeah. Yeah, I remember enjoying that show quite a bit.
And this was an earlier, where it's more prominent now, I think, than it was maybe back then, for the court of popular opinion, where people were very quick to be on Lizzie's side. And I think maybe that was because of the way that she was being portrayed by Horsea in the court. And they really started to sympathize with her, which, of course, I think that had the outcome of the trial.
Plus, she had very high standing. They were obviously a family of some wealth, although the father made them live in a quite restricted way. Yeah.
Eating that old mitten with flies.
She was clearly someone of considered to be, you know, of prominence. You know, the family had a prominence in town, so that was also working to her advantage.
And she wanted to have more. You know, when she was there having that conversation about, you know, what they call you, skint flint, you know. You know, stuff like that. And afterwards, when the trial was over, she did live at a higher standard.
Yeah.
After her father died too.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Something else I had popped in my notes was about Catherine Hellman's character, Emma, who was brilliant as well. We didn't see a lot of her in this, but she, you know, what we did see of her, she was fantastic. And one of the things that struck me was at the end of the trial where Lizzie is found not guilty and she's calling for Emma to go with her out into the outside the courthouse to get into the carriage. And she's kind of on her own and she's being escorted out, but she really wants Emma there, you know, and Emma's nowhere to be found. You know, and then she comes home and Emma has just left the scene and gone home without her. And Emma was quite supportive of her in many ways. But what I wrote in my notes was that, you know, why didn't Emma stay with her at the courthouse after she was found not guilty? Because Emma actually believed that she was guilty. She was actually quite worried. Mm. that Lizzie had done that. And that said something, you know, mm-hmm. that brought it back around again. You know, someone as close to her as Emma, we would tend to sort of believe her suspicions, you know, and her sense of uncertainty about, you know, a not guilty verdict. Because I think she did believe she was guilty, because she actually asks her.
Yeah, she asks her at the beginning, did you kill father?
Yeah, but at the end, mm-hmm. she does it as well.
Yeah. And then there's another scene where she goes, you frighten me when you get like this, Lizzie.
Mm.
Right, so yeah. Mm-hmm. There was definitely a suspicion of doubt that came from. Yeah. In real life, they died months apart, didn't they? Lizzie went first, and then, Emma went first, and then Lizzie went first. I don't know. They were months apart
mm-hmm.
in death, so.
Yeah, I had a note on here that after the trial, Lizzie lived in the same town of Fall River, Massachusetts, until her death in 1927. She changed her name to Lizbeth and bought a large house, befriended an actress, although it didn't say which actress, and donated money to animal welfare. She was shunned by most of the townspeople and never married. Mm-hmm. So it's just such an interesting case. There's so much mystery around it. One of the other things I found, which I thought was amazing, was that according to some sources, Elizabeth Montgomery was related to Lizzie Borden. They were allegedly sixth cousins once removed, both mm-hmm. descending from a 17th century Massachusetts resident named John Luther. It's not clear if Montgomery knew about this connection before she died. She did not mention it in any interviews or biographies that the author of the article on the internet could find. But it did say that she was fascinated by the Borden case and that she wanted to portray Lizzie as a complex and sympathetic character. So whether she felt some sort of strange kinship with that character, or with that person, or it could have just been coincidence. So that's yet another mysterious
mm-hmm.
thing, maybe, you know, swirling around the case.
Maybe, mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe she was channeling Lizzie yeah. Borden. That's another
interesting. That would be cool. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's some very, very cool things about this one.
And Irish actress Finola Flanagan, who was, you know, the maid, Bridget mm-hmm. Sullivan, was originally from Ireland.
Mm. So a
bit of casting,
casting
information there.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I would give this one, you know, probably 5 out of 5, really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so would I. Yes, I was thoroughly, like I said before we started this, I watched this like 5 times now. Because I had to do it to check to see if I was able to watch for the show and then, you know, edit, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. And I just, you know, each time I watch it, you notice new things about the performances mm-hmm. in the show. It's so good. Yeah, I definitely recommend this one as a movie for people to watch, especially if you're really into like Lizzie Borden's story, mm-hmm. and history and stuff like that. Because mm-hmm. I would love to go to the house.
Yeah, it's
correct.
Yeah, is the house still standing, and mm-hmm. is it occupied? And I'm assuming that
it's
there's
a museum now, I think.
Yeah. Oh yes, okay. Yes, I think I read about that. Come to think of it, for awards, it says the film won the writer William Bast the 1975 Edgar Award for Best TV Feature Miniseries, It also won 2 Emmy Awards for costume design and film editing, and received nominations in 3 other Emmy categories, including lead actress for Montgomery, which is shameful that she didn't win, art direction, and sound editing. It was also nominated for Best Motion Picture Made for Television in the 1976 Golden Globes. Mm-hmm. So it made a huge splash at the time.
You can see, really see why. And then, of course, we got the European version, which is the one that we watched. It's more explicit in the theatrical version. Showing Borden. It says they showed her nude, which they didn't really show her nude. You get to see her. Bit of a, you know, her nipple, but that's about it.
I quite liked that too.
Her mother, so
I quite liked that too, because it was enough to illustrate the cleverness that she was showing, so that she wasn't going to get any blood on her clothes. And the calculating steps of washing all the blood off herself, and just, you know, walking to different parts of the house. And a bit nervous seeming, because she was aware that she was pressed for time and she had to get things done. But the fact that she would just do that, walk around the house, and then just calmly, like, you know, rinse herself off and things like that, it was trippy. You know, you for 1 minute you think you're watching this, you know, absolutely cold-blooded killer, and then the next minute you think, mm-hmm. Is that the same person?
Yeah. Yep. In a way, she discards the axe down the latrine, but and just walks away. So, like,
yeah,
I just did that. It's a thing.
Yep. Yeah. So definitely well worth a watch. Can highly recommend this one.
We'll definitely give it, let's say, 5 coffins instead of 5 thumbs up. 5 coffins.
Oh, yes. 5 out of 5 coffins, then. Yeah, for sure.
5 out of 5 coffins. All right. We have a bit of a time, so why don't we chat a little bit about Hands of the Ripper. And I thoroughly enjoyed this movie. You know, I thought I hadn't seen it in quite a long time, so I really wasn't in my memory until I watched it again. And I'm like, oh crap, yeah. And I forgot how much I really enjoyed this movie.
Yes. First sentence, I enjoyed this movie. It was my first time seeing it. I've got Eric Porter's performance was brilliant, as were all the other actors. Darren came up with, he picked up on something about the actress Linda Barron, who played Long Liz, who was best known to UK audiences as Nurse Gladys Emmanuel in the Corner Shop sitcom Open All Hours, where she starred alongside British comedy legends Ronnie Barker and David Jason. She also made 3 appearances in Doctor Who as a singer in The Gunfighters in, is that 96 or 66? As Val in 2011 in a Matt Smith episode, Closing Time. And she wonderfully chews the scenery as the villainous Rack in the season 20 story Enlightenment with Peter Davison.
Amazing.
Yeah, so truly brilliant actress. Truly brilliant.
That was my second note that I made. Oh, I see in the credits. Linda Barron is in it. I was going to do the Doctor Who thing. So I thought that was quite cool.
Yeah.
And the poor kid gets his mother killed in front of her.
Oh, I know. It was quite an opening. It's a really, again, very disturbing opening. And I think, again, you're looking at you're left guessing, right? She's witnessed this as a very, very young child, and the impact that that's had on her. And then you see how she has, you know, she's turned out, you know, as the movie goes on, and how she's triggered by certain things, flashing light. I think it was. It's been a couple of weeks since I've seen it, but she's triggered into almost like a trance-like state, and she just starts murdering. So you're left to wonder, is it because of what she witnessed, or is she possessed, you know, by the spirit of her late father?
Mr. Jack the Ripper.
Yeah, so it's it leaves you with that slight mystery of which it really is.
The music in this was very well done too. It's
it's for anyone that hasn't seen it. At 2 years, the daughter of Jack the Ripper is witness to the brutal murder of her mother by her father. 15 years later, she is a troubled young girl who is seemingly possessed by the spirit of her late father. While in a psychotic trance, she continues his murderous spree, but has no recollection of the events afterwards. A sympathetic psychiatrist takes her in and is convinced he can cure her condition. However, he soon regrets that decision. And right off the bat, like I said earlier, Eric Porter, fantastic actor. I mean, his acting CV is, you know, incredible. Such a well-known stage actor as well. And Garrett Reese as Anna was very effective. She was very good.
Adorable too.
Yes. Very pretty girl. And then you had the actress Jane Murrow, who played Laura, who was in a sense, I guess, the future daughter-in-law of Dr. John Pritchard, because it's Pritchard's son who was courting her. And one of the big things that really jumped out when we were watching this, how weird was the Dr. Pritchard's son, Michael, played by Keith Bell, did he not look like Edgar Allan Poe?
Yeah, he did. Yeah.
We were both like, holy cow.
Yeah.
He had the sideburns and the hairstyle and the facial expression, everything. I was just like, whoa, which movie is this?
One of my notes I had on the side, I said, Eric Porter would have made a really good master. And would have made a really good Moriarty. And then I'm like, wait a minute. He did play Moriarty.
Yes. Yeah.
In Jeremy Brett's
absolutely. Series. And he was very good. He was quite frightening. Amazing, yeah. Man. He was excellent.
And we go back to Jane Merrill. We saw her this season on Horror at 37,000 Feet.
That's right. She, beautiful actress, very unique features, and just her mannerisms and her delivery were brilliant. And when she played Laura in Hands of the Ripper, the scene where she's blind, but yet she's quite not at peace with it, but she's kind of like, for somebody in her condition, she's very calm and pleasant and doesn't seem to be overly jealous or anything like that. And there's a scene where towards the end of the movie in that big dome at the top, that Laura the whispering room, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And she's trying to talk to Anna, and Anna has stopped responding because she's been triggered mm-hmm. by the, you know, by flashing lights or something. And then she starts to make her way over to Anna, and the suspense of that scene was superb.
Yeah, the directing was amazing.
Yeah. And then the Dr. Pritchard, after he's stabbed by Anna, mm-hmm. he gets the word to his son that Laura is there, you know, with Anna. And so that wonderfully timed scene where the son is rushing there, Laura is slowly feeling her way around this, you know, to get closer to Anna, and the close call of what could have happened, and then how Eric Porter's character, through sheer force of will, forces himself there, although he's literally dying, mm-hmm. And manages to lure Anna and sort of mesmerize her enough so that she sort of throws herself over the balcony. It all just culminated so beautifully. It was amazing.
Yeah, her death was very well done. The cinematography, I mean, you can't really show death as being beautiful except in this movie, because the cinematography and the way that she threw herself off the balcony and how slowly they showed her in with her mm-hmm. with the clothing like flopping in the wind as she's falling, you know what I mean?
It was very cinematic. It was very dramatic. And at the same time, it was just this incredible shock at the end, you know, where she just falls and hits the ground, and how they sort of frame that at the end. As I say, it's been a couple of weeks since I've seen it, but I remember that particular scene really staying with me.
Yeah, and Pritchard saying to her, "Come to me."
Yeah.
Come to me, Anna. And you're like, all right, what's she gonna do? Go down the stairs? No, she's gonna take the easy way and fly down.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
she's in that kind of state, isn't she? Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So she's it was so suspenseful because you're never quite sure what's gonna happen.
And you kind of feel for her too, because it wasn't her fault, but she was being possessed by mm-hmm. her father. The other death that really bummed me out was Dolly, the maid. Poor Dolly had good intentions, but she had to go.
She was lovely. I know. She was a really likable character. And she was, and that's what made it so shocking as well when Dr. Pritchard finds her and what's happened. Because, as you just said, Anna is quite a sympathetic character. Because of what's happened to her, and he sees that, and he's kind of torn, I think, with wanting to really honestly help her, but also to further his studies and his career. He comes across as a very principled, good man, in, you know, from when I watched it, but yet he's again from a time when, you know, it was that, you know, that we were discovering things for the first time that we take for granted today. So it was all new. It was all just new discoveries. And he was so determined to use the skills that he had to try to cure her. That's what made it so sad, was how it ended, you know. And I felt a lot of sympathy for his character.
Another character I really liked was Elizabeth, or Margaret Rawlings, rather, as Madame Bullard.
Bryant Bullard? Yeah.
Yeah. She was the one that sort of like the psychic kind of thing, who who knew that she was there's evil in this girl. I could sense it there, you know. And her death too was quite poetically done. You know, it's very Shakespearean the way this movie plays out.
That's it. That's a really good that kind of nails it. Yeah. It does have that feel.
With Edgar Allan Poe in it.
Yeah. I know. They totally could have made an Edgar Allan Poe movie and cast that guy.
Yeah,
that was amazing.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this movie. I mean, the one thing that Hammer did well was really give good dramatic performances on a shoestring budget.
Yep. They knew how to create a mood. They sure did.
And this movie was no exception.
Yeah, that's why I just love Hammer movies.
Yeah. Yeah, me too. You know, other studios needed to take note. You know, you don't need to spend a lot of money to prove a point. You know, you can do it with performances, good performances, proper direction in cinematography.
And set dressing.
Dressing.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful girls.
Yes, they definitely had those. and that, again, that's their signature. And I think that's great. You know, I mean, I think it has something for everyone. If you like horror, you know, Hammer horror is fantastic. You had, again, you know, I always loved the sets and the backdrops. You know, they had me at like, you know, the sets in a lot of the Hammer movies right off the bat. Mm-hmm. Just trying to find something I thought of when I was watching this. Let's have a look. You might have to do a bit of editing on this one.
Well, while you're doing that, there was a couple other notes that I made.
Mm-hmm.
There was a line, "Don't squeeze the fruit unless you're going to buy it." I thought that was a
Oh, God. Yeah, I forgot about that. They were funny. Some of those girls were really funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And another thing I said, Linda Barron's character, Long Liz, was cool and fun, but she didn't last very long.
No. No, she was. She was. And then you did wonder she didn't really seem to, she seemed to be fun and quite looking out for Anna in that situation. But at the same time, I think she was sort of sizing her up as well.
Mm-hmm.
To sort of, you know, mold her into something.
Yeah. And she wanted to mold her herself, I think.
Yeah. 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 There was Yeah. Yeah. She did look a little bit. There was a funny quote under the critical reception notes. It got my attention, and it says Andy Boot considers the film, quote, flawed and so close to the fag end of gothic that it could almost be a parody, but that is, quote, nonetheless a film well worth watching. And I thought that was a really odd thing to say, but I love the way he said it. I just love how it was phrased.
Fag end of gothic.
Yeah, I've never heard that expression. Quite me like either. You know, put it quite like yeah, that me. Before.
Hmm.
Yeah,
there's only two types of fag that I know, and that would not be how I'd say gothic would be. I don't know.
No, it was. It's an interesting comment. And film critic Leonard Maltin gave the film 2.5 out of a possible 4 stars in his review. He stated that the film had, quote, a good atmosphere and solid performances, but after a good start, dissolves into a series of bloody murders. And I read that and I was thinking, well, yeah, that's because it's about a series of bloody murders.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just like,
you're going to have the hands of the Ripper. What is it going to be? Just like,
yeah, it's, you know,
screen or something. Hello, my baby. Hello, my darling. Hello.
And then in the Hammer story, the authorized history of Hammer Films, wrote that the film, quote, expertly mixes the sophistication expected of Hammer's films with the gore its new audience demanded. And I would agree with that the most. I think it has a little bit of everything. It's got that Hammer-esque quality, as you know, sophistication is a good word. The sort of Shakespearean, almost Shakespearean element that you mentioned, but it's also got, you know, it's also quite shocking and gory. But in the context of what's happening, you know, so I will call out gore if I find it done like OTT.
Distastefully, yeah.
Distastefully or just thrown in for the sake of throwing it in. And it doesn't really work, you know, with the rest, the overall tone of the movie. But this works for me. I didn't have any issues with it at all.
Yeah, neither did I. I mean, it's, I mean, I didn't even find it overly gory for a movie with the name Ripper in it. I mean, the scene where Long Liz has a thing sticking out of her eye.
I mean, that was hard to watch.
That was really hard to watch. And with the slit throat of poor Dolly.
Yeah.
But it wasn't too overly done.
Yeah.
And I've seen other horror hammer movies where it was overly done.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Yeah, and they do themselves a disservice when they do things like that, I think. But yeah, I thought this film delivered the shocks that you would expect it to deliver. Mm-hmm. But they didn't spend an overly long amount of time on those scenes. I don't recall. Mm-hmm. So it was enough.
Yeah. And we can almost say the same with nudity as well. In movies where it can be too much, but then it can be just enough. And I think something that Hammer did, especially in the 70s, where it showed a lot of nudity, but it was tasteful. It wasn't anything too, I mean, where, you know, when we watched Creature this season, that didn't even have any nude scenes in it because you know, it didn't really warrant it, but you know what I mean? Where
so,
a lot of the Hammer movies, like, I mean, there's a scene where Anna's in the tub. Or she's in a tub, so she's going to be naked. And he doesn't show her that much. You see her boobs a little bit. You don't see them a lot. In, like, say, another off the top of my head, Vampire Lovers. Sure, nudity in that, but it was scenes and stuff like that.
Well, that said, I mean, it, and I think with Hammer, they loved to celebrate the female form, I think. And I think that's one of the things that they just did so well. And as you say, you know, usually tastefully in that sense, but there was a real celebration of the female form. And I think that was part of the allure of the Hammer films, because you felt like you were watching an artistic film. You weren't watching something that was just gratuitous.
Yeah.
You know, it was all very interwoven well, I thought.
Shakespearean art. You know, when you talked about Hammer being more celebratory towards the female form and stuff, another movie just popped into my head when you said that. And this movie called Vampires. It's another 70s movie. And it's about two lesbian vampires who go on a killing spree in this house. It's actually really well done. I was kind of hoping to show it on our show, but there's some, like, But if you ever, anybody listening wants to watch that movie, I really highly recommend it because it's very well done. There's a death scene towards the end that really graphic, that really grips you. It's a very well done movie. But at the end, I mean, Hands of the Ripper, another five coffins out of five for me, because I really enjoyed that.
Yeah, I would say the same. Five coffins out of five. Yeah, I would definitely like own a copy of this if you know, I saw one out there somewhere. And the same with the other film we watched as well. You know, I was quite impressed with both.
Yeah, The Legend of Lizzie McGuire. The Legend of Lizzie Borden. Wouldn't that have been something if they showed that for Lizzie McGuire? Yeah, no, it we just, you know, copied two really good movies.
And, yeah. Yeah, definitely. And I'd love to chat about some of the other horror ones on some later shows if we can, you know, the ones that we can't show, but obviously ones that we've watched or can watch. Mm-hmm. Cause there's quite a few Hammer productions that I want to catch up with that I might have seen many, many years ago, but that I haven't seen with fresh eyes. So definitely up for some more Hammer.
And anybody who's listening along, if they have any requests of ones that you'd like to hear us talk about that we can't show on our show, mm-hmm. let us know. Drop it in Sounds the comments good. Below and say, hey, try, you know, can you discuss, say, like The Entity with what's your name?
You know,
at our age, we you know, the names escape us quickly.
Yep, it's called early senility, folks. Welcome to old age.
Yeah, that's right. And on that note, we're going to say goodnight on our very first B-movie Cryptcast, and hopefully you guys enjoyed listening along to us talking about two fantastic movies that we highly recommend you watch.
Yeah, and please leave your thoughts in the comments, what you thought of these films, and we'd love to read them.
Mm-hmm. All right. That's it, everybody. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Trouble needs a home, girls. Trouble needs a home. She fell out with Satan. Now she's on the